Welcome, everyone. It's a pleasure to have you join us today. My name is Rawi Abdalal. I'm the faculty director of the Davis Center for Russian and Eurasian Studies. And I am thrilled to have the chance to put us in conversation with a good friend, a brilliant intellectual, and a thoughtful interlocutor between cultures and genres. So I'd like to introduce to you Dr. Maxim Shrayer. He is a professor of Russian, English, and Jewish studies at Boston College. And also at Harvard, he is the director of our project on Russian and Eurasian Jewry, which he has undertaken as a labor of love for the past several years. And it is a great pleasure to have a chance to hear some of his thoughts on the marriage between Véra Slonim and Vladimir Nabokov. As you know, probably, if you're tuning in, Maxim is a prolific author across a wide range of genres and in multiple languages. And so it's a real pleasure in these difficult quarantine times as the country is seemingly on fire to take a moment to reflect together on some other questions, which are not altogether unrelated, as Maxim, I think, will note. So with that introduction, Maxim, thank you so much for joining us today again, and I hand it over to you.
Thank you so much, Ravi. Good afternoon. I really appreciate this generous introduction, and I'm going to share the screen in a minute. I just want to say again that we're very grateful for the support of our sponsors, Genesis Philanthropy Group and the Center for Jewish Studies, and of course, our own Davis Center and our brilliant staff, because they've managed to create not just talks, but real events. So I hope you enjoy this. This talk, I am going to touch on key questions in the history and culture of Jews from the Russian Empire and the Soviet Union, as well as questions that I think are especially relevant for today's American and Canadian Jews. I will speak of the so-called mixed marriages, about the price some Jews pay and others refuse to pay for entering the mainstream, and also about the boundaries of modern Jewish culture in diaspora. I should also like to add that this is also very much a Boston story, because Vladimir Nabokov and Véra Nabokov, Véra Slonim, got to know America and became Americans in the 1940s in the Boston area, in Cambridge and Boston suburbs. And so I think they would be particularly sensitive to what we Bostonians are living through today. I should also mention that this work stems in part, and Ravi mentioned that, from my early archival research on Vladimir Nabokov and Russian emigre culture. It goes back at least a couple of decades. I started thinking about it when I was working on the world of Nabokov stories. I was still thinking about it when I was writing Bunin and Nabokov, The History of Rivalry. But in a sense, it is also connected with some of my non-academic writings, particularly my memoirs, Waiting for America and Leaving Russia, which deal with Jewish emigration from the former Soviet Union. So I'd like to start by just perhaps amusing you a little bit, but also I suppose upsetting you a little bit by telling you how I originally became interested in this topic. So imagine, the year is 1994. I'm finishing my doctorate at Yale. I'm possessed with a desire to know everything about Vladimir Nabokov. At the time, the Amherst Center for Russian Culture at Amherst College had just acquired the papers of Zinaida and Ioan Shakhovskoy, born Dmitry Shakhovskoy. He is the one who later became a monk and the Archbishop, John Archbishop of San Francisco. So I go there. The holdings had not yet even been cataloged. I'm going through the holdings, various boxes, and I come across a very curious letter, which you have in front of you here, from one Igor Krivoshein to one Zinaida Shakhovskoy. We will return to Zinaida Shakhovskoy in a little while, but who was Igor Krivoshein? He was Nabokov's coeval. He was born in St. Petersburg in 1899. He died in Paris in 1987, so he outlived Nabokov by almost a decade. He was, as they used to say when I was growing up, a боевой офицер, a frontline officer during World War I, and then during the Russian Civil War, he emigrated to France, and actually his life was, as compared to many of his contemporaries, educated Russians, quite successful. He became an engineer, graduated from the Sorbonne, had a very successful professional career. Now, the marriage part is interesting. He ended up marrying a woman by the name of Nina Mishirskaya. She's the one who eventually became Nina Krivosheina. Her big claim to fame in Russian culture is Sergei Prokofiev had at one point been in love with her. In any case, we're now during the occupation of France. Igor Krivosheyn becomes an active member of the resistance and is specifically active in trying to rescue Jews. In 1944, he is arrested and sent to Buchenwald. He was liberated from there in 1945, and then, like some other emigres, he became intoxicated with this pro-Soviet, Russian-Soviet patriotic spirit, and he and his family decided to go back to the Soviet Union. And as you can well imagine, both Igor and the son of that couple were arrested, and it wasn't until 1974 that Igor Krivosheyn was able to return to France. Now, his wife published a fairly well-known memoir. It's probably best known, some of you may recall the film East West, which featured Catherine Deneuve and Oleg Menshikov, and it was partially based on a kind of whittled down version of her memoir. So I'm looking at this letter, which you have before you, dated August 4th, 1979. This is a letter in which Igor Krivosheyn is describing Vladimir Nabokov's youth and transformation following the marriage to a Jewish woman by the name of Véra Slonim. Now, let's just pause and reflect on one pertinent fact. Igor Krivosheyn is not a card-carrying anti-Semite. And in fact, his record was quite admirable. Imagine, he was in the resistance. He was rescuing Jews. And here is what he is writing. I quote, "My mother knew Nabokov in Berlin. He complimented her on pure Russian. And she told me how before her eyes, following his marriage, N became completely enjouivé. Probably this explains much in his self-abnegation, as if out of matrimonial gentlemanly solidarity." And just so you believe me, the very bottom of the letter, the last line, you see there is a Russian word совершенно followed by the French word enjouivé. It's almost as though he doesn't have the Russian word to convey what he's trying to say. What is enjouivé? If you find a decent French dictionary, it will tell you that this is the past participle of the verb enjouivé, which comes from the French juif, for Jew. It is not a loving way of describing how one is transformed by Jews, how Jews have a certain way of transforming people. It is rife with prejudice, which does not translate well into English. Jewify just doesn't sound right. And in Russian, объявлялся also doesn't quite have the flavor. So it's a kind of translingual letter that is essentially saying Vladimir Nabokov was a nice Russian boy from a great Russian family, and quickly he becomes completely transformed under the influence of this Jewish woman. When I read that, it's like some lightning bolt went out in my head. You know how that we tell young students that as researchers, we have these moments of clarity. I suppose this was a moment of clarity for me, because somehow I saw that some sort of narrow hanging bridge was pointing out of Slavic studies into Jewish studies, but also I became particularly interested in Jewish questions in Vladimir Nabokov's career and in Russian emigre culture. So that's a kind of roundabout way of explaining to you how I became interested in this, and the topic is still with me today. Now, it was hardly a conventional, hardly a bourgeois marriage. It was an artistic marriage, life and text conjoined. Most of my works have been dedicated to my wife, and her picture has often been reproduced by some mysterious means of reflected color in the inner mirrors of my books, Nabokov said in a 1971 interview. the story of Vladimir Nabokov and Véra Nabokov, arcing over two continents and at least five languages, is both old hat and barely worn fedora, really depending on what you read and where. Brian Boyd, Nabokov's monumental biographer, documents some aspects of the Nabokov's marriage. Stacy Schiff, who wrote a biography of Véra Nabokov, also details some aspects of Vera's transformation into Mrs. Vladimir Nabokov. And I also just want to draw your attention to this wonderful book, which came out a few years ago, lovingly curated by Olga Voronin and Brian Boyd. These are letters to Véra, Vladimir Nabokov's letters to Véra. They really help us appreciate some of the inner workings of this marriage. They reveal much about the Nabokov of flesh and blood. He was passionate, emotional, needy, and vulnerable. He was intolerant, noble, brave, and chivalrous. These are, above all, letters about love, letters of love, letters about love against all odds. First for Véra alone, and then for Véra and their only son, Dmitry. Vladimir writes to Véra with the flame of a young poet and the sophistication of a verbal conjurer. A few examples. This is 24-year-old Vladimir in Prague, where his mother was living at the time, writing to almost 22-year-old Véra in Berlin. This is the eve of 1924. Quote, I love you very much. Love you in a bad way. Don't be angry, my happiness. Love you in a good way. Love your teeth. And here is Nabokov in Paris on April 7th, 1937, writing to his wife in Berlin as they tried to negotiate both an escape from Nazi Germany and the survival of their marriage in the midst of Nabokov's affair with a younger emigre. Quote, I dreamt of you this night. I saw you with such hallucinatory clarity and all morning long have been going around in a sort of cloud of tenderness for you. I felt your hands, your lips, hair, everything. And finally, this is Nabokov writing to Véra on April 10th, 1970. This is one of those rare occasions when they were apart during the last decade of their marriage. My gold-voiced angel, and in Russian it's Zolotogolosy moy angel, my gold-voiced angel, can't get out of the habit of these endearments. And the aspect of verbal conjurery here is almost as important as the message contained in these letters. Nabokov's sister Yelena Sikorsky called Véra an aristocrat of the spirit, not the name, obviously underscoring her origins, not in the Russian nobility, but also her high moral ground. What was Véra like? Slicing and fearless with her perfectly coiffed silver hair, her regal bearing, a gun concealed in her handbag. In another life, little Véra Slonim may have become a commissar of the arts had she stayed, or perhaps a premier of Israel had she made Aliyah, but she had only one realm to guard and represent to the world. This was a kingdom both authored and ruled by Vladimir Nabokov. Her last name, Slonim, bespeaks her ancestors' origin in a town presently in Belarus, but of course historically on the borderlands of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania and Kievan Rus. She shared her distant origins with the founders of the Slonimer Hasidic dynasty, but also with a co-founder of Marks and Spencer. Her parents belonged to the generation of Russia's Jews, many of them nurtured by Maskilic ideas, who got to taste the palliative reforms and hopes of the 1860s and 70s, and then saw much of the phantom opportunities taken away in the late 1880s. To Jews of the same vintage as Véra's parents, Russian culture became, I would argue, something of a sanctuary. But the synagogue was still always the temple. Véra's father, Yevsei Slonim, was a brilliant lawyer, a graduate of St. Petersburg University. In 1889, he left the legal profession because of a imperial ukaz which barred Jews from practicing law. So he obviously chose Jewishness over practicing law. He refused to convert to Christianity, even if pro forma, even to Methodism or Lutheranism, as did some Russian Jews seeking a milder conversion. And So he remained with his faith. What is important also to point out, as we anticipate the moment when young Vladimir and young Véra meet in Berlin, is that the Slonim sisters enjoyed a first-rate European upbringing in St. Petersburg, and as young emigres in Berlin, certainly felt no less culturally European than did the other educated Russians. Another woman marrying a non-Jewish man might have followed the example of Katya Mann, born Pringsheim, who adopted not only her famous husband's name, but also his Lutheranism. Véra was different, and this is where Vera's line was drawn, not in the sand, but on loyalties of memory, blood, and spirit. Let's pause for a moment and sort of reflect on a somewhat speculative question, which is, had they both stayed in Russia and not emigrated, would the probability of their coming together have been higher or lower than in Berlin? So what would the likelihood of their meeting in emigration? He, a scion of such an aristocratic wealthy family, she, a woman of Jewish origin. I think on the one that in emigration, certainly a family like the Nabokovs would have been likely to insist on Vera's conversion. But Nabokov, Vladimir Nabokov, was different. And his manifest public behavior did not only stem from his upbringing and remarkable parents. His father was a famous advocate for Jewish equality and one who was outspoken against anti-Jewish violence in Tsarist Russia. But also, and in fact, in 1922, Nabokov's father would be killed by a would-be Russian fascist. Nabokov's son Dmitry, in 2011, when I was interviewing him in Montreux, specifically about his parents' marriage, said this: "My father very much shared his own father's very strong opposition to anti-Semitism, was close to Jewish culture in many ways, not typical for a young Russian man of his time and milieu." Already in November and December of 1923, Vladimir was sending Véra long letters full of desire and passion and confessing love. And I should add also that a deeper mutual enrichment of Jews and non-Jews was hardly new, of course, in the circles of Russian intelligentsia. Even so, Russians known for their publicly professed philo-Semitism voiced private exasperation with marriages of Russian aristocrats and young Jewish women whose paths crossed in emigration. I think a case in point is Ivan Bunin, Nabokov's master, the first Russian writer to win the Nobel Prize in 1933, who had many Jewish friends and associates who during the war rescued three Jewish people in his villa in the Maritime Alps. And in fact, Yad Vashem is considering adding Bunin to the ranks of the righteous of the nations. And yet in his private diaries, in his diaries, they were private at that time in the 1920s, Bunin, for instance, permits himself the following intemperate comment, quote, "Prince Vladimir Argutinsky Dolgorukov walked me home and on the way told me about Prince Galitzin, who in Berlin married a Jewess for 75,000 marks, which incidentally is not that much money. It's about $7,000 by today's standards." And then Bunin continues, "These marriages are getting ever more frequent. Jewesses becoming countesses, princesses, finishing us off, purchasing us up." This is April 7th, 1922. Bunin's view, expressed about a year prior to the meeting of Véra and Vladimir, anticipates the hushed puzzlement over Nabokov's choice of a bride. When Véra and Vladimir were married, it was a civic ceremony in Berlin at Rathaus Wilmersdorf. Nabokov's mother, from the beginning, from the very beginning, embraced Véra. Nabokov's grandmother, Baroness Korff, asked one question about Véra: "Of what religion is she?" That was to her really the most important thing. When it came to religious identity, Vera's stance was more in line with the prevalent position among the Jewish exiles, who were, as I pointed out before, people of Russian culture, yes, yet proud Judeans. So in other words, it wasn't about religion per se. It was probably more about non-conversion, if one could make this distinction. Now, neither of the young Nabokov spouses was observant, and in my opinion, a practical compromise must have been easier to achieve than in many other mixed marriages. What we do know is that Vladimir Nabokov had stopped going to church by the middle 1920s, only attending services for family weddings and funerals. And in that sense, his departure from Christianity or any organized religion may be linked, albeit not casually or directly, to his marriage to an unconverted Jewish woman. We do know that already in the 1920s, some of Nabokov's relatives and emigre colleagues, even some of the people he was close to, privately debated Nabokov's marriage to a Jewish woman. This culminates already after the war, after the Shoah, in the 1970s, at a very different time when Zinaida Shakhovskaya, who in the 1920s and 30s was a close interlocutor of Nabokov, a huge batch of their correspondence survives, writes a book called Poiskakh Nabokova, In Search of Nabokov, which is essentially a story of Nabokov's alleged withering under his wife's influence. And this book reopens old wounds because many of the first wave emigres are still alive. And Shakhovskaya, in her own words, wrote this book against Vera. In Russian, it's considerably more powerful. Protiv Veri, and it's unclear if she was aware of her own bilingual pun, meaning against Vera the person or against Vera the faith. Protiv Veri. And there's a whole polemic that surrounds this book's publication, different emigres taking different sides. So when I started the talk and when I quoted from Igor Krivosheyn's letter, it is very much in response to this book where he says that Nabokov became enjoué. Now, if I suppose Sol Bellow, who incidentally called Nabokov a cold narcissist and had a very competitive attitude when it came to him, if Sol Bellow were reflecting on this, I think what he would say is that in the Russian emigre mainstream, as opposed to its ultra-nationalist fringes, Vera's Jewishness wasn't an issue, but it somehow still was an issue, particularly because Vera herself never shirked or apologized for her identity. When asked at public events, Dmitry Nabokov, when he was still alive, would usually say that he and his parents did not have a religion. Of course, students of mixed marriages know that questions arise when one's children are born. So in December 2011, the last time I saw Dmitry Nabokov, because he would die less than 2 months later, I specifically asked him, I said, I'm interested in knowing whether your parents ever talked to you about religion. And he replied as follows: we never had that problem, and neither did I. I sang on Fridays, and I think on Saturdays at a wonderful, would it be, Reform synagogue in Boston, and we sang stuff like some of the most difficult and modern religious music by Ernst Bloch. And yes, it was never much of a problem. And after some research, I think I have identified the synagogue. This is the biggest Brookline synagogue, Temple of Abbe Shalom on Beacon Street. So what's particularly interesting about this, imagine in the American 1940s, while living in the Boston area, Dmitry was a student at St. Mark's Preparatory School, and he was on the one hand singing Jewish liturgical music in a Reform synagogue, but on the other hand, he was singing in his school's choir. Of course, the school, like most such schools, are under the wing of one of the mainline Reform Protestant denominations. He was singing Handel's Messiah in a Protestant church. So I think that was very interesting for me to discover, because clearly a certain openness survives after the Nabokovs flee Europe and become Americans, which is not to say that Nabokov's marriage to Véra did not change his life. I think it did. And I think it awarded him a personal connection to the Jewish past and present. I'm gonna pursue that a little bit. In a sense, there is a temptation to regard the Nabokov marriage in the mirrors of his work. And of course, critics like to do that. There's nothing wrong with that. And in that sense, people like to look at Nabokov's longest, most ambitious Russian language novel, Dar, the Gift, and the changing attitude of its main protagonist, Fyodor Glinov-Cherdintsev, a Russian aristocrat married to Zina Mirz, a half-Jewish woman, and to say that somehow it co-opts Nabokov's own transformation, sort of formerly a liberal belief in the equality of all people, and subsequently what Nabokov describes as a personal shame for listening to anti-Semitic rot. This is all very helpful, I think, for Nabokov himself. Jewish joy and Jewish suffering become not those of another, but his own. But what about his fictional alter ego, Fyodor Glinov-Cherdintsev? We will return to this question a little later, because I want to get into the rise of Nazism. Because, of course, Véra and Vladimir and their young son live in Nazi Berlin, in Nazi Germany, until 1937. And in fact, it's remarkable that they stay so long. I actually once asked Dmitry about this, and he said, look, it's very difficult to explain rationally, because of course the writing was on the walls of history. He said, my father really had a certain inertia, and also he was working very prolifically. Nabokov was writing some of his greatest works at the time, and they basically procrastinated until it was almost too late. Because of course, after 1935, after the passing of the Nuremberg Laws, Véra and their son Dmitry, of course, become vulnerable. Directly vulnerable, not just as Jews, but also as emigres, doubly vulnerable. Russian bigots called Nabokov himself a half-Yid. There is actually an article that survives in a fascist Russian newspaper in which there's a kind of list of Jewish artists that is, whose names are all printed with lowercase, and there's a call to cleanse the national art of these, and the list goes on, and it includes the Syrians, Syrian is Nabokov's Russian pen name, the Chagalls, the Knuts, the Burluks, and etc. So Nabokov is literally seen in that article as a Jew through his marriage to a Jewish woman. And later, when Nabokov was reflecting on this period, particularly in his memoir, Speak Memory, originally written in English, in its 14th chapter, there's a particularly ponderous moment, I think. He's addressing Véra as you, and he writes the following, but whatever the truth may be, we shall never forget, you and I, we shall forever defend on this or some other battleground the bridges in which we spent hours waiting for our little son, aged anything from 2 to 6, for a train to pass below. Now, which trains is Nabokov speaking about? I think reading this in post-Shoah light would reveal more layers of memory than simply thinking about it as a reflection on a young emigre boy looking at trains passing through even before the passing of, say, the Nuremberg Laws. Now, the German troops advancing toward Paris, the Nabokovs fled from France in May 1940. They fled on board the Champlain, which is actually a boat chartered by the Hebrew Immigrants Aid Society, and it's taking Jewish refugees to New York. Nabokov consistently refers to his first American years as quote unquote happy, or even his happiest ones, which, by the way, sometimes gets on the nerves of some Russian patriots, because obviously the enemy was at his homeland's gates and he's speaking about these happiest years. I don't think there's any contradiction, because Nabokov had rescued his two most beloved Jews, his wife and son, and as a husband, as a father, and I suppose even as a Christian, he experienced the happiness of their survival. That's why I think those were the happiest years, not because of what was going on around them, both in Europe and at home. Let's talk a little bit more about Véra herself and how and the dynamics of their marriage. She was a woman of many talents and rightly belongs among Russian culture's most celebrated wives. And yet, unlike Nadezhda Mandelstam, to take an example well known to readers outside Russia, Véra did not seek a literary fame of her own. She was literally living and working in her husband's shadow, like in this famous photograph, where, as you can see, Nabokov's hand is almost protecting his wife, right, from the paparazzi. Some of the happiest photos which have survived, like this one from 1927, this is when they were vacationing on the island of Rügen on the Bay of Pomerania, they do not have corresponding letters. And in fact, the challenge with what survives from the Nabokov's correspondence is that sometime in the 1960s and early 70s, Véra destroys her letters to Vladimir. So virtually nothing survives, a few occasional notes, but nothing of literary substance. And so the predicament we face is how to read this marriage only in light of what has survived on the Nabokov side, and this silence, this great silence of Véra. And it is, of course, a challenge, and it invites some speculation and the imperfect art of conjecture. Now, I just want to show you, of course, the correspondence that survives is ample, and it is full of Nabokovian endearments, many illuminated letters like this one, and it's a treasure trove. But the problem I mentioned remains. Also, just to point out in passing, Nabokov's letters to Véra are not just letters of a husband to a wife, a lover to a lover. They're also a kind of history of Russian emigre culture in exile, because he details Russian emigre life, particularly his visits to Paris in the 1930s are such a treasure trove of knowledge. And sometimes reading these letters is a bittersweet experience, as during the spring of 1937, when Nabokov is in Berlin in the midst of a tempestuous affair with a Russian emigre. Sheer madness. His wife and son are in Nazi Berlin, and he is writing to her almost every day, detailing the Russian emigre literary life, but also sort of in a coded way, communicating his own turmoil. These are difficult letters to read, and difficult material to contend oneself with. Actually, I found particularly revealing this letter that Nabokov writes to Véra on April 15th, 1937, which is their 12th wedding anniversary. And he writes, my love, how long since you stood in front of me in your prim little robe, and how much new there will be in my little one, and how many births, words, games, all kinds of little things I have missed. And then almost without a transition, he writes, poor Ilf died, and somehow one thinks of separating Siamese twins. I love you, I love you. Of course, Ilya Ilf and Evgeny Petrov were Soviet writers who co-authored their fabulously famous satirical novels until Ilf's death dissolved their partnership. Why is Nabokov talking about that? I don't think he's just chronicling the death of one of the co-authors. I think one cannot help but suspect that he was thinking of his own partnership with Véra. And this partnership survived the trial of infidelity and separation. However, threads, stitches, and wound dressings holding the marriage together also penetrated the fabric of Nabokov's fiction. And in that sense, marital discord framed by the advent of World War II and the Shoah seep into part two of Nabokov's novel, The Gift, which I mentioned earlier. So basically, if the complete novel, as we know it, ends on a note of anticipatory happiness, as Fyodor and Zina are about to become one, in the second part, which is set in Paris in the 1920s, the marriage is unhappy. They're childless. Fyodor cheats on Zina with a French prostitute, and Zina dies, run over by a car. I wonder why Nabokov gave her such a death. I think perhaps it is more of an authorial rescue from a much more terrifying death. Imagine what awaited a Russian Jew in the occupied France. Remember the Villa de Rondiver and things like that. So in a sense, this is not just authorial punishment. It is also authorial rescue. And that in turn brings us to the Nabokovs in America. And I just want to talk a little bit about what is going on in the way the legacy of Russia is also still alive, and that legacy brings with it the legacy of Russian anti-Semitism. The escape to America, of course, introduced new encounters with the Jewish question. A Russian aristocrat of the sort that they used to call white Russians at the time and his Jewish wife found themselves at new boundaries, tasting both of the genteel anti-Semitism of the Anglo-Saxon intelligentsia and of the more outspoken bigotry of the American mainstream. And I just want to talk a little bit about Nabokov's travels in the South, and how he describes them in some of the letters to his wife. He is, of course, trying to spare her some of his impressions while also reflecting on racism through the prism of Russian anti-Semitism. When I speak about this in Russia, of course, the audience is familiar with segregation in the South. What they're not familiar with are these kinds of signs which surround Nabokov and his wife and young son on their travels in New England, in upstate New York. For instance, Nabokov at one point makes a trip to Cape Cod, to Wellfleet, to visit Edmund Wilson. And there are fancy hotels that routinely have signs like this, no Jews, no dogs, or, you know, no Jews admitted, or more coded, like near churches or Gentile clientele only. So this is not just a story of the segregated South. It is also the story of Nabokov's life in New England as well. And so this is a letter that Nabokov writes on October 2nd, 1942. He is in Hartsville, South Carolina. I quote, "To the West, cotton plantations and the prosperity of the numerous Cokers who seem to own half of Hartsville is founded on this very cotton industry. It is picking time now. And the darkies, an expression that jars on me, reminding me distantly of the patriarchal yid of Western Russian landowners. Выражение, которое меня коробит, чем-то отдаленно напоминая патриархальный жидок западнорусских помещиков, pick out in the fields, getting a dollar for 100 bushels. I'm reporting this interesting data because it stuck mechanically in my ears. Then there are no letters between 11 November and 7th of December, 1942. However, Nabokov is continuing to reflect on the experience of the segregated South and racism as he writes to his closest American interlocutor, the writer and critic Edmund Wilson, and I'm going to soon conclude, but hear this. He is writing about a train he took and a scene he witnessed. Old man in the lounge, really lavatory of the Pullman, talking volubly to two nice, self-controlled, unsmiling privates. The main words he used were Christ, hell, and fucking, coming all in a bunch toward the end of every sentence. Horrible eyes, black fingernails, somehow reminded me of the militant type of Russian Chernosortinets. This is a member of the Black Hundreds. And as if in answer to my passing thought, he started on a wild attack against Jews. They and their pissing children, he said, and he spat into the wash basin and missed several inches. So in that sense, Nabokov is sparing Vera some of the experiences of anti-Jewish prejudice. He's trying to spare her because these are difficult years, but there is a deep linkage in his reporting racism and anti-Semitism. And I think we can only imagine what was spoken about in the inner circles of their family and marriage. The post-war American writings of Nabokov are suffused with various Jewish questions, including, of course, Nabokov's novel Pnin, which is one of the first novels about the Shoah, which includes a detailed description of Jewish death in a death camp. I want to conclude on a happy note, or a happier note. So after Lolita made Nabokov tremendously famous, he was about to leave Ithaca and move to Europe, he thought temporarily, although he never returned from Europe and of course stayed in Montreux. A famous photojournalist was dispatched to Ithaca to document the Nabokov's life and marriage. His name was Carl Meidens. He was not at all a photographer who covered culture. He's most famous for his photographs taken from the Japanese surrender on the USS Missouri. And yet he's sent to do a series of fabulous photographs of the Nabokovs. He documents everything about them. Here they are, as you can see, running with butterfly nets. And here, a very tired Vera is typing on a typewriter. As you can see, Vladimir Nabokov is reflected in the mirror. Presumably, he is reading, dictating to her. She's taking dictation. Why do I like this photograph so much? Because I think it brings to mind Nabokov's probably favorite work of European painting, the famous portrait of Giovanni Arnolfini and his wife, by Jan van Eyck, which has this famous convex mirror, right, that reflects the artist. In that sense, right, one could say that Vera was a constant presence in the convex and concave mirrors of Vladimir's life and vice versa. And in these mirrors, she was the main Jewish character of his universe. What has she done for him? Well, of course, she's done many things. She has co-authored much of his life. She scripted and sculpted it. She gave it trajectory. She grounded him and guarded him. She saved him from Mayakovskian suicidal anguish. She managed his literary affairs with tremendous savviness and perhaps some say ruthlessness. And she really, after the 1937 crisis, took charge of his life. And when Lolita became famous, she then took on the management of her husband's public image, which Dmitry Nabokov continued. And that brings me to the grave to which, after Dmitry's death, his name was added. It's a grave at a cemetery in Clarence near Montreux. And it's an area where other members of mixed marriages are buried. That includes Sidney Chaplin and his wife Henriette, and Oscar Kokoschka and his wife Olga. So, truly in closing, I just want to return to December 2011. I don't have time to show you a clip, although it is available, but I just want to quote what Dmitry said when I asked to summarize the essence of his parents' marriage. And he said, "My mother did more for my father as a person and a writer than anyone else in the world could have." I'd like to stop here. Thank you very much.
Maxim, thank you so much for sharing those thoughts with us. It's a fascinating story. We've had a few questions come in, and I think we have about 15, 17 minutes to take a few questions.
Perfect. And let me just stop this. Do you like the background, or shall we stop the share? Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, we're all good.
Yeah. So let's do this. Yes.
So I've got a few questions that have been submitted, and I'm going to allow myself to combine a thought that I had with one of the questions. And I was very much struck, as you seem to have been, in the sort of intellectual history of your relationship with Nabokov and the borders between Jewish studies and Russian studies, with this word enjuive and the various meanings it might have. And certainly your suspicion must be correct that it was not meant kindly. But I wonder, do you have a sense from either Nabokov's fiction or his letters if he developed a sense of pride in it, that this was not a badge of honor, as it were, to be accepted by a community that he respected, but some sense that he might have replied had he heard this, yes, indeed, and rightly so, and I'm proud of these things. Do you have a sense of that element of his personality?
Ravi, it's a great question, honestly, and I don't think a question that has been sufficiently explored, in part because there is a dearth of evidence. A dearth of evidence of Nabokov reflecting on the Jewish question and on his marriage to a Jewish woman in the discursive form. So we have to go on the basis of fiction and on the basis of the epistolary heritage, eyewitness accounts, stories of behavior. Of course, Nabokov becomes publicly intolerant of even hints of other people's, not just open prejudice, but discomfort, which I think changes his and Vera's social circle. But that is not enough. I don't think it's quite what we're probing here. The question is, does he take on Vera's Jewish battles? And I think in some sense he does. And I'm gonna say something that everybody's liking, but it's what it is. Nabokov, for instance, becomes an ardent supporter of the young state of Israel. He writes in 1967 to his former friend from the Petersburg Gymnasia years, who becomes a architect in the British Mandate and then in Israel, Samuel Rozov. He says, basically, I celebrate Israel's fabulous victory, in paraphrase. So some of these things, there is a record of. Now, to go back to the question, the transformation, I think he is very grateful to his wife for giving him new optics, because I think an observer of Jewish life or Jewish Russian or Christian Jewish relations certainly often needs optics that are not naturally or historically given to him and her. And I think Vera gave him those optics. But those optics were very, very strongly focused. And Vera's Jewishness had a particular angle. I'll give you one example. So when she reads Sol Bellow, who is, in my view, one of the geniuses of American literature, but who of course mostly writes about Jews, she says, I must tell you, I'm a Jew myself. I've been, you know, living with other Jews, but I have never met the kinds of Jews of which Mr. Bellow writes. So, I mean, imagine that. Yeah. So, Ravi, thank you. Yeah. This is a question that I hope to pursue, but obviously you cannot just rely on pure conjecture here.
Fascinating. So thank you for that. There are a couple of questions that have come in, not unrelated. And you mentioned several times the artistic quality of their marriage. And one gets the sense that it was very much a marriage of intellectual equals, that he regarded it as such. And so you reflected a little bit on her contributions to his professional life and various elements of management of his career. Two questions related to that. So one is, and this has come in from the chat, I'll paraphrase it. Do you think she got what she wanted in terms of how she tried to shape the trajectory of his literary reputation. And in that sense, like, was she satisfied with how he ended up? And then the second question is somewhat related. Separate from her professional management of him and his image and his work, do you have a sense of how she might have contributed to his development as a writer, simply as a writer, as an intellectual? Like some hints and sense of her intellectual contributions. Like, could it be said that perhaps he would not have become the writer that we knew without her intellectual contributions, well, separate from the professional?
As you know, his son, their son, Dmitry, very much believed that. Mm-hmm. Very much believed that. And there is an extended answer where he very much argues that it was the opposite of what that emigre perspective argues for. That, you know, it was such an enrichment, such a transformation that he wouldn't have become a great writer without this Jewish woman for whom he was the life of her life, her obsession. So now, going back to the question, I think, of course, after Lolita's stellardom, she became quite satisfied. In a sense, all her efforts had paid off. Her tremendous patience, her endurance, and also the kinds of services that he provided, his driver, his teaching assistant, his typist, his proofreader, his agent, his communicator. Absolutely. And in the last 20 years of their lives, I think were professionally tremendously rewarding, but also existentially. But I do think it came at a price. I think the marriage had ruptures. It was not seamless, even though after in the 1950s, the Nabokovs began to cultivate this Olympian seamless image, which almost left not enough room even for public Jewishness in it. But privately, not just the affair of 1937 and other infidelities, but the general sense that it was living with a very difficult person. I think Véra was bearing the brunt every day. And lastly, development as a writer. I think absolutely so. I have argued in the past, for instance, that without Véra, Nabokov would not have written with such complexity, for instance, about Jewish-Christian relations and mixed marriages. And I think the American works, I think we probably would have not had Lolita.
Fascinating, fascinating. Do you think, and this is, I mean this just as a very small question, almost a throwaway question, but do you think that there's any sense in which they regarded his literary career as their career? Or was it really her work in the service of his career?
It's a very interesting question again. And I think I would answer it in two ways. Certainly Véra, who was amply gifted, certainly held back when it came to her own creative impulses, and I think channeled them through her husband's, and not just living vicariously, but trying to shape and inform his life and his career. But two, yes, I think there are some places in his writings where Vera's imprint is felt more strongly. Again, in my view, in the American works, more so than the Russian works.
Interesting. So another question about the mixed marriage and the challenge of the mixedness of it. Mostly you reflected from his side, but I imagine that there were challenges on the side of her family as well. And I wonder whether you could just say a few words about how her family felt about her not marrying a Jew, which must have been difficult, especially in the context of what was increasingly becoming a precious and scarce identity in the context of what's going on in Europe. Absolutely. And then also this sense that he was transformed, We don't have her letters, but do we have intuitions and hints about how she herself was transformed by this intellectual, artistic marriage?
Yeah, no, these are fabulous questions. There isn't a ton on the side of Vera's family, but I think in addition to some of the things I said about the background, of course, her parents, particularly the father, belonged to the creme de la creme of culturally Russian Jewish intelligentsia. And of course, they had a greater openness when it came to this. Certainly, the day when Vera married Vladimir was not a day of mourning in for the Jewish relatives. Furthermore, we should take into account that Vera's both sisters also married non-Jews. For Vera, the line in the sand was, as I believe, non-conversion, as opposed to anything else, that she remained herself. She remained a Jewish woman who was unapologetic. And I think probably this was sufficient to her family, in addition to the fact that, of course, Nabokov himself, not only because of who his parents were, but also because of who he was really not a person of any, at least to the best of my knowledge, measurable, even implicit prejudice. That too was important. Be it as it may, I can tell you this, when I learned that Dmitri sang both in Shul and in St. Mark's, somehow this opened a certain door onto the marriage, because clearly they openly entertained both religious Jewish identity and religious Christian identity in their marriage. That's unusual, even by American standards of the 1940s.
Absolutely. A couple of questions have come in that invite you to be, I think, a little more wildly speculative than is your temperament.
Which, of course, I'm trying not to. And
yeah, but times being what they are, and the technology being what it is, if we could imagine, in a kind of contextless way, this partnership between these two people today, how do you imagine it might have been different? And I think here of two elements that our listeners would like to hear you reflect on, but I find them interesting too. So, for example, insofar as she was his intellectual equal, what might she have been? Would she have been a writer herself? Would she have pursued other forms of artistic or literary expression? If we reimagine her in a different context, in a moment when a writerly couple like this might have two writers living in the house rather right. than one and a support system and a contributor. So how can we imagine her today with different kinds of opportunities and perhaps a different kind of relationship? And then also imagine him today and what he might chronicle on our behalf were he writing in a different moment.
Yeah, great questions. I mean, these questions did not come naturally to me when it comes to this particular mode, because of course, I am speaking about this as a scholar with a lot of archival connections rather than a writer who of course speculates unduly about imagined life. But nevertheless, so if we imagine that they're not products of their time, but today's Véra and Vladimir, different, but today's, I do think that fundamentally the marriage would still have a similar dynamics, although I think I can well imagine Véra becoming a wildly successful blogger. I don't know why, but that's my intuition. Mm-hmm. And I think partly because she would have found the form somehow not competing with her husband's mm-hmm. literary art. I doubt she would have become a writer in her own right. She also might have become an academic, because, for instance, she had tremendously strong training in languages. Her son always spoke about his mother's brilliance and depth of knowledge. He would ask her about a small reference in the Hebrew Bible and she would give him a lecture back. So I think an academic career, right? Mm-hmm. Now, the second question.
Also an honorable one, we must say.
Absolutely. The second question, look, I might as well tell you what I'm thinking. I think if they were talking about today, I think they would be talking about this traumatic intersection of racism and anti-Semitism. I think I can't imagine how they would not have. If they were reading in the papers about a Jewish community being vandalized in response to police racist brutality, I think they would have understood how, in some sense, incongruous this is. And I think they would have been uncomfortable, as I think I am today. Because in a sense, where else could they go?
Mm-hmm. Well, we are just about out of time. And so I will just invite you to share one or two other thoughts about what you hope to do with this project and what comes next intellectual curiosity for it.
It's been a book in the making for many years. I've written about aspects of Nabokov's Jewish connections and Judaic connections. And I almost have enough material. Although, of course, one longs for the kinds of things, Ravi, that you asked after, but it's in the pipeline. In other words, I think it would be a book that would explore the marriage specifically as history and literature.
Well, we all look forward to the book when you have the time to write it. Thank you so much for joining us, Maxim, and thank you everyone for joining us for this fascinating conversation. Please keep yourselves up to date with various Davis Center activities, including Maxim's project, and we look forward to joining you again soon.
So thank you so much.